Okay. Go ahead, Christy.
All right. Thank you, Jubal. And thank you, everyone, for joining. Welcome. Going to be doing today's new director leadership orientation training on the child and adult care food program. So I'm Christy Pasulo, soon to be Christy Baker. I've recently gotten married, haven't changed my name quite yet, but it's happening soon, so look out for that. I was born and raised on Long Island, New York. I live in Virginia now. And I got my start in the Head Start world just over 8 years ago in Philadelphia, working as a nutrition manager at a Head Start program that CDI Head Start was managing. And I'll share a quick story. When I first started at that program, one of my cooks came up to me and asked for some edits to the menu. So I thought, okay, no problem, I can do that. But she said, you need to ensure that the meals are especially hearty on Mondays and Fridays. And I'm thinking to myself, well, that's an unusual request because usually, you know, staff ask for things to be a little bit easier for themselves on Mondays and Fridays. But she kept going and she said that for many of the children that we're serving, those are the days. The meal that they eat here on Friday might be the last good meal that they have until they come back to the program on Monday. So I'll never forget that. That's, I think, one of the things that still motivates me today and makes me realize how important this job is. And I'm grateful for the Child and Adult Care Food Program because it's one of the resources in the Head Start world that helps make a difference in that respect. So I'm glad to be here to give you all a little bit of training on the Child and Adult Care Food Program today. So before we get started, if you could test out your chat boxes, let me know what program you work with and how many years total you've been working in Head Start in any capacity. And as you're typing into the chat box, I'll just introduce the rest of the CACSP team at CDI. We have three CACSP field specialists, Monica Elguezabal, Sandra Johnson, and Rochelle Lyles. And we have, at the moment, two consultants that work with us, Adam Parmenter and Sharon Dillier.
I don't know what's up here, Christy. Hey, you guys, are you got your chat boxes going? Are you with us? We're going to have many more interactions like this, polls, chats, so please tune in. Hello, hello. Huh.
Awesome. Thank you. I see them starting to come through.
Okay, good.
All right, awesome. Just from the people who responded so far, we've got about 71 plus combined years of experience in Head Start. That's awesome. So now that I know your keyboards are working, I'm going to ask you to unmute yourself and let's test out your microphone.
You are. So,
all right, a little bit of feedback. Are we able to use the speaking or?
Yeah, we can, but somebody is probably, I don't know. I think that happens when you're on speaker and your computer goes into your phone or something like that. Let me unmute each person. Okay, we'll just find out where which person maybe is.
Okay. Well, as we figure it out, try to think about what you hope to take away from today's training.
Oh, do you want people to type here?
No, if they could verbally tell me what they hope to take away. So if you are unmuted and you're able to speak now, please let me know what you hope to take away from today's training. And if you're not unmuted and you want to type it in, you could do that too. Right. Is there anything that you want to find out about or get more information on or be able to do related to the food program?
I'm just going to type it.
You got a chat there from Maria.
All right. Be able to train staff. Accurate. Understand the importance of meal counts and attendance. Those are all great, and I think we will definitely cover some of those topics today.
Nice.
All right, so you got out of talking for this one, but warm up your voices because I will ask for more participation again later. Okay, so these are some of the outcomes that I have identified for this presentation. I want the program director to have a basic understanding of the CACFP. For you to be introduced to CDI Head Start's record keeping system that we use with all of our programs, and to understand your role as it relates to the child and adult care food program. So I'm going to start off with the what and the why. What is the CACFP and why do we participate in it? And I also want to mention just for fun, so that you know, all of these pictures in the presentation are pictures that came from the local programs under CDI Head Start. So all of these were posted to your program pages, and I encourage you to keep doing it. We love to see the pictures of all the kiddos that we're serving. Okay, so CACFP, the Child and Adult Care Food Program, it's a meal reimbursement program. The reimbursements are based on yearly rates and the number of meals that are served that meet the CACFP requirements. The reimbursements are not based on the full cost needed to operate the program, and we'll talk about that in more detail later. But the program allows for us to provide nutritious meals and snacks to all of the kids that we're serving at Head Start and for other programs at other eligible daycare centers. The CACFP is funded by the USDA through their Food and Nutrition Service Department, but it's administered on a state level. So in some states, it's run by the Department of Health or the Department of Education or the Department of Agriculture. It varies from state to state, but programs like CDI Head Start apply to sponsor the CACFP through their state agency. And CDI Head Start is one organization. You may have heard the motto, one team, one dream. So that means we can only have one active application in each state that we're working in because we're one organization. So if CDI has more than one local program in a particular state, then we share the same CACFP application. And why do we participate in the CACFP? Well, it's a Head Start performance standard to utilize the CACFP funding as the primary source of payment for meal services. But a lot of thought and research goes into the standards. It's not just do this because I said so. It's not, there's a reason behind the standards. And it's to improve the overall program. In this case, in particular, with this standard, using CACFP funds reduces the amount of Head Start funds spent on the cost of meal services. So when we have funds from CACFP that are specifically for the meal service of the program, then it allows us to have a better quality of meals for the children. And the other reason why is because the USDA has nutrition standards in place already that vary based on the age of child. So it meets the unique and changing nutritional needs of the children that we're serving from the time that they're infants and early at Head Start up through the time that they transition to school. And I mentioned that it is a reimbursement program. The reimbursement is updated on a yearly basis from July through June every year. And there are different rates. There's the free rate, the reduced rate, and the paid rate, which is based on the income of the family participating in the program. However, all Head Start participants are categorically eligible for the free level of reimbursement, which means we get the highest amount back for each meal that we serve because of the population that we serve. The categorical eligibility is for Head Start is extended to early Head Start and to the up to 10% of enrollees who are over income. And the prices listed here, again, are just for this year. And this, in particular, is for centers. Family daycare homes have different rates. And it's also just for the lower 48 states, Puerto Rico, and D.C. Hawaii and Alaska have different rates as well based on living expenses. So we only get the reimbursement if we serve an allowable meal. And as we say in Head Start, if you didn't document it, it didn't happen. So that's where the meal counts come in. We call it the meal counts or the point of service meal counts or the roster of meals. It is the method of counting meals so that we can submit a claim and get reimbursed for what we served. And they call it point of service because it should happen immediately after the meal is served at the point of service. Depending on what state you're in, it's either marked on a form by each individual child or by a total head count of how many kids are in that classroom. And it's different from attendance. Meal counts and attendance are not the same thing. They're both required and they should support each other, but they are different. So for example, if you have 10 children in attendance in your classroom, you may or may not necessarily have 10 children claimed for breakfast, lunch, and snack. So for example, if Johnny was feeling sick, and he went to the health manager's office and he missed lunch, then you might only have 9 children claimed for lunch that day instead of 10 because Johnny was sick and he was out of the room and he never got served the meal. Okay. The other thing with attendance that would support the claim is that you could never have, if you have 10 kids in attendance, there is no way that you could have 11 kids marked on your meal count sheet, because then we don't know who that other child is. All right, staff sometimes eat with the children. Their meals are not reimbursable, but they should still be recorded as a record to ensure that we prepared enough meals for everyone who was eating. This is just some CACFT lingo. These terms are used pretty interchangeably. Allowable meals, same thing as creditable meals. In other words, it meets the regulations and it's eligible for reimbursement. And the way that we get reimbursed for those eligible meals is by submitting a CACFT claim. So the claim is the data that we submit that includes the number of creditable meals that we served, plus any supporting information that the state might ask for. So in some cases, that's your attendance for the month, the number of days you were in operation that month, your enrollment number, and what your expenses were for food service that month. Our goal in CDI is to submit that every month by between the 10th and 15th of the next month. And in most cases, that is submitted online through the state's website. There are a couple of states where it's a hard copy form that's filled out and mailed in, but for the majority of the states, it's done electronically. And then every month, that information gets forwarded to your assigned field specialist with CDI to be reviewed to ensure accuracy. All right, so free money isn't free. There are requirements that need to be followed in order for us to get the reimbursement. So this next section is going to cover how we know if our meals are creditable and other CACFT regulations that are required to be met in order for us to participate in the program and get the reimbursement. I'm going to ask for some audience participation again. So if we can unmute, please share with me a CACFT requirement. Any requirement you could think of, something that we need to follow in order to get the meals reimbursed, or that we need to follow in order to participate in the program.
Christy, we might be better off using chat.
Yeah, just because of all the feedback.
There keeps being a little bit of feedback.
Okay.
So why don't you say it one more time? I'll type it.
Okay,
what do you want people to
respond
to?
In the chat box, let me know a CACFT requirement.
Oh, okay.
Okay, I see some coming through, meal portions, meal components. Any other requirements for participating in the program? Okay, the point of service meal counts. Very good. Any other requirements you can think of that might not be related to the meal? Yep, following the meal time. Very good. Okay, awesome. Perfect. Okay, so these are all right, and we will go into those a little bit more. And most of those will fit into some of these categories that I have outlined. So these are the requirements that we're going to cover in a little more detail throughout the next few slides. And most of what you mentioned will be covered in these topics. So we've got meal components, monitoring, training, fiscal accountability, record keeping, and civil rights. Okay, and
you might want to turn up your own volume for the video.
Yeah.
Where our fingers are a little bit crossed here.
I am going to put my headphone microphone up to the speaker on my computer if I could figure out where the sound comes from. So I hope that you could hear this, but this is just an introduction to meal components.
The foods chosen for meals are another vital component of family-style dining.
We go by what the CACAP program requires us to do, going to their guidelines as far as knowing what breakfast, lunch, and snack is. For breakfast, 3 items. For lunch, 5 items. 2 items for snack.
Okay, so hopefully you were able to hear that. Chef Gregory from that video introduced the 3 different meals that we serve at our programs: breakfast, lunch, and snack. And he mentioned in the video that breakfast has 3 components, lunch has 5 components, and snack has 2 components. So I'm going to ask for more participation in the chat box. If you know of any of the required components for any of the meals, just share that in the chat box. Okay, so I see some good ones coming through and some common misconceptions. We'll definitely go through it. So we've got milk, we've got fruit, we've got vegetables. We've got some mention of whole grain, which isn't a component on its own, but it does fit into one of the components. So that's good, and it is one of the requirements. Okay, thank you. So the meal patterns vary by age group, so who we're serving, and by what meal we're serving. And I'll start with some of the key requirements for the infant meal pattern. So first of all, we are required to encourage breastfeeding. So to encourage breastfeeding means to promote it, to provide facilities to properly store and handle breast milk, to to make accommodations for any mothers who want to come into the program during the day and feed their child on site, and if needed, to provide any referrals to lactation consultants. Within the infant meal pattern, there are two different age groups. There's the 0 through 5 months and 6 through 11 months. So in the first group, 0 through 5 months, the only required meal component is breast milk or formula. And then once they turn 6 months is when solid foods are part of the meal pattern. So it is possible that solids could be introduced earlier or later than 6 months of age, but 6 months is when it shows up on the meal pattern. So if it's before 6 months and you're feeding them solids because that's what they're developmentally ready for, then that's okay. It's just an extra component that they're serving on top of the breast milk or formula. And if it's a little bit later, that's okay too, because it's about whenever they're developmentally ready for the food. And then infants who cannot sit on their own must be held while they're being fed. Important for the socialization and development of the infant. And then for our toddlers and preschool, there are two age groups again. There's a serving size group for 1 to 2 year olds and for 3 to 5 year olds. So the components for both of these groups are the same, but the serving sizes are a little bit different. There is also a requirement specific to milk, which varies by age, but does not follow the same groups as the serving size groups. So the requirement for milk is that one-year-olds are served whole milk, and once they turn 2, that they get switched over to 1% or fat-free milk. The meal patterns also have limitations on sugar, so for things like cereal and yogurt. We limit juice to once per day to cut down on sugar. And we are not allowed to serve grain-based desserts. So no cookies, cakes, pies, brownies, cereal bars, things like that. All right. And then water is not a CACFP component, but we are required to offer and make water available. It shouldn't replace milk, but we should offer it throughout the day. All right, so we have a little pop quiz now. So you don't have to speak or talk, but I'm going to pull up a poll with a multiple choice question and ask you to click on the correct answer. Jubal, are you able to pull up the poll? Because I'm not seeing it on. I don't know if it's my settings. And to answer the question in the chat, 1 year olds are required to have whole milk. And once they turn 2, it goes down to 1% or fat-free. So nobody in the program should be on 2% milk unless there's a medical need for it with a note from a doctor. Did I lose you, Jubal?
No, sorry, I'm with you. You're ready to launch a poll? You can't launch the poll, apparently, huh?
No. I don't know. Am I not a host anymore? I'm not sure.
Oh, you know what? When you logged back in, I probably need to make you host again. Uh-oh. Wrong. Okay. I don't want you guys to do that one. Because I just sent the original one. Okay. I'm making you co-host again.
Okay. All right. Now I've got it.
All right. Now, do you see a list? Okay. Forget that one. That first one? Oh, wait a minute. We don't want that one. Oh, drop down menu. You are so smart, Christy. You're
all
so much
right,
better so. At this than I am.
It takes a village. All right, so answer this question. So you're going to identify the correct meal component category for the food item mentioned. So the poll you should be seeing now, the food item is tater tots. So you're going to click on whichever of the choices there that you think is the correct answer. Which category do tater tots fall into? Okay, so I think I've got responses from the majority of you. So the majority of you said bread or grain component. Some of you said meat alternate, and some said vegetable. So I asked this one specifically because it tends to confuse a lot of people. So this is the response that I expected. The correct answer is vegetable. So even though potatoes are a starchy vegetable, they are still considered a vegetable. So they would not fall into the bread grain component, even though they're starchy. They would still fall under the vegetable category. All right, we're gonna try another one. This time it's cheese. So which category do you think cheese falls into? All right, and don't worry about wrong answers. We're all here to learn. And I can't see who's giving what response, so don't worry. All right, and I think we've got most of our responses in. And there was a little bit of confusion, but most of you did get the correct answer. It is meat alternate. So cheese falls into the meat alternate part of the meat alternate component. It is dairy. But in the CACFP, the milk component is only milk and no other dairy items. All of the other dairy items fall under the meat alternate category. So it's a little bit different from what you're used to with the food guide pyramid and the My Plate. And I'm just going to ask one more, and this one is potato chips. All right, I tricked some of you on this one. So if it was going to fall into a component, it would be a vegetable because we said it's a potato. However, in this case, it's none of the above because potato chips are not an allowable component in the food program. So you were kind of all right, but technically we're gonna go with none of the above for this one. All right, thank you all for your participation in that. We will have one more set of poll questions a little bit later. All right, but just to recap and finally go over what those components are, just for background information, this close-up is of the chart for the 3 to 5-year-olds group. So the components are going to be the same, but the serving sizes are slightly different. But for breakfast, the three required components are milk, a vegetable, fruit, or both, and a grain. And then a new regulation is that you have the option of serving a meat alternate up to 3 times a week for breakfast in place of the grain. Recap for the lunch components: milk, meat alternate, a vegetable, a fruit, and a grain. So all those are all 5 of the components. So one of everything is required for lunch. And then for snack, we've got all 5 of the components to choose from, and we have to serve any 2. So any 2 different components. All right, the next requirement is self-monitoring. So monitoring is used to determine the compliance strengths and needs of the program. They have to be conducted 3 times for every center each year. During the monitoring, the monitor will observe meals. So there's 3 visits per center each year. The guidance is to do a different meal at each of those 3 visits. The visits should be unannounced, meaning the center staff doesn't know that they're coming to do a visit until they're there, so that it's an accurate representation of what happens on a day-to-day basis. We're not allowed to have more than 6 months pass between visits. New centers have to be visited within the first 4 weeks of operation. And these visits should be scheduled on your administrative calendar. However, when you're putting it on your admin calendar, you want to note the month only. So just the month that the visits are planning to occur, and not the actual date, because once you specify the day, it's no longer an unannounced visit. All right, and then follow-up visits. If there's something out of compliance and we need to do a corrective action plan, then a follow-up visit needs to happen within 30 days of the visit, and that follow-up does not count towards one of the 3 required visits. And to do these monitoring, there is a state form. Each state has their own monitoring form to be used for this purpose. Training is required yearly and upon hire. So who do we have to train? We have to train all staff with any child or family interaction. So essentially that is all of your staff. So pre-service is typically the best time because it occurs yearly, allowing us to meet that yearly training requirement. But we also don't want to forget that we have to train new staff when they're hired before they start doing the tasks we're asking them to do. So the minimum required topics are listed here, but they really depend on what your job responsibility is. And then some states have additional training requirements or specific webinars that they require to be viewed. And again, if you didn't document it, it didn't happen. So we always want to keep records of any training, so agendas, sign-in sheets, and copies of the handout. Fiscal accountability is also important. The CACFP is giving us money, and we need to spend it within their regulations. So all institutions participating in the CACFP must operate a nonprofit food service, which means we cannot have excess money in our CACFP account and start using that to cover other Head Start costs that don't relate to the meal service. So for example, you cannot say saltine crackers and grape juice is a really inexpensive snack, so let's serve that every day so that we have money left over at the end of the month to take the kids on a field trip. That would not be allowed. So the funds that we spend, the funds we get from CACFP that we spend is restricted to allowable costs. We give the state a budget and let them know what we're planning to spend our money on. And that's all that we're allowed to spend it on. And we can't use it for anything that's not allowed to be used in the program. So for example, we can't serve cake. It's one of the things that the grain-based dessert, we can't serve cake. So if we buy cake, we cannot use CACFP funds to pay for it. We keep copies of all our invoices and receipts to show that we're only purchasing things that we're allowed to. We're required to go through the bid procurement process for any large equipment or contracted meal vendors. And then just a note, the CACFP year is October through September. So the CACFP year does not follow your local program budget year. They are on different calendars. And then record keeping, we use the table system. We also refer to it as binder 1, 2, and 3. There are 8 tabs in each of the binders, but it doesn't have to be set up in binders. The tabs could be in a file cabinet, but every tab that's part of the system should have information behind it. That's how that we know that your record keeping is complete. And we use it for standardization across CDI Head Start programs to make sure that we have all the records that we need to meet the requirements of the program, and it helps us to make sure that we're ready for audit. We are required to maintain CACFP records for a minimum of 3 years plus the current year. So eventually when your local program transitions to another grantee, it's the responsibility of the local program to box up all of the CACFP records and mail them to Denver so that we can make sure that we are meeting that requirement to keep records on file for so many years. And then we always opt to use the state forms whenever the state has something, a template form available for use. We go with what the state is requiring. If they don't have something, then we have CDI Head Start forms that could be used. But we prefer to go with what the state has because sometimes that's a requirement and other times it helps in the audit process because that's what the state is familiar with. So the first of the three binders or categories for the table system is the organizational records. That's things like your application. So in terms of the application, from a program director's standpoint, we would want to know about any programmatic changes. So are we opening a new center? Is the center going from self-prepped meals to vended meals? Are there staffing changes in the CACFP? Maybe we lost the nutrition manager. Are the meal times changing? Anything that might be in our application that needs to be updated. So our application should always be up to date. So if there are any changes in the program, it's important that you communicate with your program's assigned CACFP specialist so that we can get those changes made to the state application. With the budget, we ask the program director to help us keep an eye on the budget to make sure we're not overspent or underspent. As we said, we can't have a profit in the CACFP budget. So sometimes it means reallocating staff salaries, or if there is equipment that needs to be purchased and there's money in the budget, then we can purchase equipment, things like that. The permanent agreement is something that program directors should be aware of. That's the agreement that we have in place with the state agency that promises we're going to follow the regulations and allow them to review us and that we're going to keep all of our records in place. And then finally, vendor contracts. We want program directors to be aware of any contracts that we are that we're in so that we know when they're going to expire, so we know if we need to rebid for a contract or if we need to renew it. The second category is the audit and review category. These are the documents that are needed for a review by the state agency. It includes things like enrollment forms that are required for all children on a yearly basis, your monitoring documentation, so those visits that are conducted 3 times a year for each center, your special diet information for any medical notes or special diets that kids have. Also important to know that a listing must be posted prominently wherever meals are served that shows what these allergies or special diets are so that the safety of the children is known so that we don't accidentally feed anyone the wrong thing. And then finally, training records. We want to make sure that HR has a plan in place for training any new hires and that the required yearly trainings are included in the annual pre-services. And the last category is monthly supporting documentation. So these are all of your records that support your monthly claim for reimbursement, things like your meal counts and your attendance and your cost information like invoices. And then the last requirement on that list was civil rights. So that's just about making sure that we're not discriminating against any of the participants in the program. We want to make sure that everyone has equal access to the program. The USDA has certain protected classes. Those are race, color, national origin, sex, age, and disability. And then some states have additional protected classes on top of those, but these are the main 6 that are covered across the board. And this poster that you see on the image of the slide is a poster that is required to be in all of the centers, somewhere that is visible to families and people that visit the center. So some programs mistakenly think that this is similar to the right to work posters. This is not an HR poster. It's a CACFP poster for our participants and not for our staff. So it should be somewhere visible to the families who come into the center. And this poster goes over the protected classes and it has a non-discrimination statement and gives information on how families can file a complaint if they feel like they've been discriminated against. Okay, and I'm going to do another couple of poll questions with you, so get your polling fingers ready. So these are a little bit shorter. So this is less options, I should say. A true or false question. Does this violate a USDA civil right? So you have leftovers following the last meal service period and you offer the extra servings to the boys. All right, perfect. 100% true. That is a violation of civil rights. That is considered sex discrimination. So treating the boys differently than the girls. And how about this one? A center does not provide infant food and/or formula to infants in their care and requires parents to supply these items. This one, true or false? All right, we got a 50-50 split on this one. This was a tricky one. So it is a violation of civil rights because it discriminates against age. So we can't say that we're not providing any food or formula to infants. There are some allowances to allow certain items to be brought in from a CACFP standpoint. However, on a Head Start standpoint, we don't want any outside food coming in, but technically we couldn't say we're going to provide meals for all of our one-year-olds, but for the infants, that all has to come from home. We could not do that. And one more. Sally is 4 years old and John is 5 years old. At breakfast, the teacher serves mashed potatoes, a quarter cup to Sally and a quarter cup to John. Is that a violation of civil rights or is that in compliance? All right, very good. Everyone got that right. That one is in compliance. So even though they're different ages and they got the same thing, it's still okay because the meal pattern for 4 and 5 year olds is the same. So they got the same serving. All right, awesome. Okay, the next topic I want to discuss is family style meals. This wasn't listed under requirements because it's not a requirement. It's a best practice. So we encourage programs to participate in family style meals to the full extent possible. And if you do, there are CACFP requirements on how to be in compliance when serving meals family style. And this video clip will explain what family style dining is.
In family style dining, children and teaching staff sit in a group around a table for a meal or snack. Food is served from bowls and platters, and milk is served in a pitcher. During the meal, the staff assist children in serving themselves and passing to the next child. Children are encouraged to help set and clean the table. It's involving the children in the meal preparation and in setting up the table and participating in all aspects. So they see the meal coming to the table and they know in advance what's coming because they're part of every aspect of the meal process. Family style dining supports healthy choices about food and encourages positive social skills. For family style dining to be successful, a positive attitude is essential from the teaching and other Head Start staff. What we try to do is model everything. So we'll take portions for ourselves. And then if it's something that, you know, might be an unusual type food, maybe something they're not used to eating, especially vegetables, we definitely try to model eating it and discussing, oh, this is delicious. Or it's green. I wonder what it tastes like. And really kind of opening up their minds and maybe they can question, well, wow, my teacher is eating it. Why not try it?
Okay. So again, family style dining is not required. It is strongly encouraged. And if you do it, these are the CACFP requirements that need to be followed. Portions, we need to prepare enough food. And also, adults are required to receive a child size. Adult meals are not reimbursable, but the child size is because they are modeling for the children. It's part of the educational curriculum. Service, all food items and components have to be served at the same time. Nothing can be held back or used as a reward or punishment. And choice, the staff are required to encourage the children to eat everything and to take all of the different foods, but the children ultimately decide what they want and how much, and they cannot be forced.
component is provided to the children by a staff person, they must provide the correct minimum portion for the child in one serving. Being knowledgeable of the correct minimum portions is the responsibility of each staff member. For example, if there is no room for even a small pitcher, the staff will pour each child a full serving of milk. The staff cannot decide to only pour 2 or 3 ounces of milk at a time due to spillage concerns.
All right, and the last area I'm going to cover really quickly is just the broad oversight and administration of the program and how to stay in compliance with the regulations. So shared accountability between local program staff and Denver staff. Again, one team, one dream. So the day-to-day operations are the responsibility of the local program staff. You're the one that's there on the day-to-day basis. So things like enrollment forms, meal counts, claims, training, monitoring, meals and menu planning, invoice coding, bid procurement, record keeping, that's all the day-to-day operations. But the Denver staff, me and the rest of the CACFP team, we help out with the initial CACFP state applications when we first start working with a new local program. We provide training and technical assistance wherever needed. We provide the standardized record keeping, the table system, and any forms that might be needed. We provide an additional level of internal monitoring, and we support the program with any state reviews. And in order to help you, we ask that any correspondences that are received by the program from the state agency, like letters about an upcoming review or a notice that there's a required training that needs to happen, any letters in mail or by email that get sent to the program, we ask that you forward those to your assigned CACFP specialist so that we could help you in the best way possible with any requirements that come up. States are required to review programs at least every 3 years. It could be announced or unannounced. So we always want to have our table system up to date. If we're found to be out of compliance for anything, if there are any deficiencies, we need to make sure we immediately stop any inappropriate actions, create a corrective action plan, implement appropriate procedures, and monitor for continued compliance. So, if we are continually found to be out of compliance with any of the CACFP requirements, it can lead to the suspension or termination of not just your program from CACFP, but all of CDI Head Start. Okay, so we just wanna be sure that we're always prepared. And the best way to facilitate a CACFP review is to always be prepared. Know your regulations, complete all the requirements, have your record keeping up to date. Sometimes reviews are announced and they'll give us a list of documents that they want to review at the audit. Your field specialist will work with the local program to review and organize all of the requested documents prior to the review so that we can be ready to go. But we want to take advantage of the opportunity of staff from the state agencies are not just there to find things wrong with your program. They want to help and help you have a good program. So always ask them for, if you have any questions, and recognize it as an opportunity to identify strengths and to find out what you need to do to make your program even better. All right, so any questions from what we went through? I think the easiest way might be to type them in the chat box, but know that you could always contact your program's assigned CACFP field specialist at any time if you ever have any questions or need any additional support. And while you're typing any questions you have into the box, this is just a little clip of some reminders of our reasons why we do what we do. All right, so feel free to continue to type any questions into the chat box. These are just some post-training readings you could do if you want to reinforce anything that we went over today. The CDI Head Start CACFP manual is available on the intranet, document number 528. And we also would like you to read your program CACFP permanent agreement, the agreement between us and the state agency, so that you're familiar with what we've promised to uphold. All right, and continue to type any questions in if you have any, but thank you for your attention and your active participation today.
Christy, thanks for a great presentation, thorough, great eye-catching slides, very compelling, easy to follow. It is this very instructional presentation, which I'm glad we've recorded because we'll make it available to all our future program directors as well. So this now becomes part of our curriculum. So thank you very much.
Thanks. Thank you, Jubal.
All right. Bye, you guys. Talk to you in a few weeks.
Yeah, bye.